Hello students, I am Sam sir, and this is the second chapter of your practical textbook, that is data processing. It's more about central tendencies. In mathematics, we talk about a term known as average, but in statistics we use more meaningful terms such as mean, median and mode, because they give a real better representation of the actual values in the real life. This is the formula for calculating the mean. It is the summation of the frequencies upon the number of values. For example, if you have these values 7, 5, 9, 4 and 7, you add them up, and because they are 5 in number, sorry, it's not 6, it's 5 in number, you add them up and divide by 5 and get the value. Then there is an indirect method of calculating mean. The formula is A is an assumed value, and it is a value that is present in all the points of data. And sigma, that is summation of D. D is the difference from the difference between the assumed value and the actual value. And N is the total number of observations. So here's an example of rainfall in different districts of Madhya Pradesh, of certain area of Madhya Pradesh. By the first method, if you do the summation of all the values, that is sigma x, that is 6484, and because these are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, so 7 values, so 6484 divided by 7 will be your mean. But if you are talking about the indirect method is also known as the coding method. In that, there is a number, 800 millimeter is common everywhere. So we subtract 800 from every value. That is 979 minus 800 is 179. 1083 minus 800 is 283, and so on and so forth. And you add them up, you get the sigma, the summation of the difference, that is 884. And then you do the calculations. Now here's an example. On the left hand side is the direct method, and the right hand side is the assumed value method or the coding method. So in the first case it was 6484, that is a total of all the districts rainfall, and divided by 7, because 7 districts were there, you get 926.29. In the second case, your assumed value was 800, because at least that much of rainfall is occurring in all those districts. So that the summation of the difference is 884 and divided by 7 districts. So if you add them up, you still get the same value, 926.29, by either method. Now median is a value of the rank which divides the arranged values into two equal numbers, and it's not depending on the actual value. So to find out the median, what you do is you arrange the data in either ascending order or descending order, and then you find the value of the middle item. Now in case your number of data is not an odd number, so how will you do it? If it is an even number, then you take the two middle values and take an average of that, and that is your median. Now here's an example. There are 7 values given in a random manner. The first thing you do is you either arrange them in increasing order, as I have done, or you can arrange that in decreasing order. It doesn't matter which way you do it. And the middle value is the n plus 1 upon 2, that value. So in this case, there were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7 values. So 7 plus 1 is 8. 8 upon 2 is a 4. The fourth value is 8172. So that is your median. But in case you have a group data, you need to have a different approach. This is the formula L plus I upon F in brackets N minus C. Here the L is the lower class boundary of the median class, and I is the size of the class interval. F is the frequency corresponding to the median class, n is the total number of observations, for that frequency, and C is the cumulative frequency, that is just before this frequency in question. Let's have a look at an example. Now you are asked to calculate the median for this distribution. So first thing what you do is you make a class that is good enough for fitting all those values, and write down the frequencies. So in the second column you can see the frequencies. At the end of that column is the summation of these frequencies, that is 3 plus 7 plus 11 plus 16 plus 8 plus 5, it equals 50. It is also known as n. Then you calculate this cumulative frequency. So 3 plus 0 is 3, 7 plus 3 is 10, 11 plus 10 is 21. Like that you do and end up till the last value. The cross check is the last cumulative frequency should be, that value should be equal to the total of the frequencies. So in this case 50 is coming in both the places. That means the way we have calculated our cumulative frequency is correct. Now the next step, which is very important, is to find the median class. So in this, when you want to find the median class, the formula is n upon 2. In this case n is 50, isn't it? So 50 upon 2, let's do it like this. So m is equal to n upon 2, that is 50 upon 2, so that is 25. Now I want you to pay attention here, because now look at the cumulative frequency column. Now where will frequency, the median, this value of m, if it is 25, where will it fit? It is less than 37 and more than 21. So it will fit somewhere between 21 and 37. So your median class, you know, the median class is that class in the first column where when you say 37, then 25 is coming within that value, within that cumulative value. So your median class is 80 to 90. This is a median class because this value of 25 is fitting. It is less than 37, immediately less than 37 in this cumulative frequency table, in this column. So what you do is just mark the cumulative frequency which is just above this. See, on the left hand side you have the median group, that is 80 to 90, and the frequency just adjacent to that is your frequency of interest. And your cumulative frequency of interest is in the third column, the one which is above this line, that is the row of 80 to 90 median group, 16F and 37. Just above 37 is your cumulative frequency of interest, that is 21, that I marked as C. Now let's see what to do. This is the formula. So in this case, see, what is important here is to know your median group, because from this is 80 to 90, so 80 is your L, so you have to take that, and between 80 and 90 there is an interval of 10. So in your formula you have to substitute this value. So L is 80 and I is 10. I is the class interval, that is between 80 and 90, it is a class interval of 10. So in that median group range, the frequency was 16, which we had marked as F, red, with a red F. And this N minus C you had calculated, N was calculated as 25. And C, if you remember, you had marked this C as 21. Alright, so you have 16, you have 21, you have the median group, you have the class interval. So that is N minus C becomes 25 minus 21. So if you solve this out, your median becomes comes out to be as 82.5. Now let us see what is mode. The value that occurs most frequently in a distribution is called the mode. So there are certain advantages of mode. You know, this is easy to understand and calculate. And if there are extreme values, then mode is not affected by these extreme values. It is easy to identify in a data set, and it is useful for qualitative data, and it can be computed in an open-ended frequency table. Now, see, look, you're studying statistics now, but just take an example of a shopkeeper. Let us say he sells footwears. Now, he has to remember, he normally naturally knows that there are footwears, certain sizes which sell more, certain varieties, certain sizes. So whenever he is placing an order on the wholesaler, he knows which sells more. So that is the mode, you know, he may not know the meaning of mode, but in reality, he is using that knowledge itself. He is ordering for the mode. So let's take an example. Now it says, this is a data given, and you have to calculate the mode. First you do, what you do it, arrange this in ascending order. It can also be in descending order. Then you see 10 and 22 and 37, 46 and 55 are not repeating. But 61 is getting repeated thrice and 88 is getting repeated twice. Now, because two sets of numbers are repeating, that is 61 is repeating and 88 are repeating, this range of numbers course is bimodal because two numbers are repeating. If three numbers were repeating, let us say there was one 22 also there in the question, then 22 would have also repeated. So then it would have become trimodal. If more numbers are repeating, we just say it is multimodal. If there is no repetition at all the numbers are there only once, then we say it is a unimodal representation. Now, in reality, the central tendency alone is not adequate to describe the distribution. The reason is that when we locate the central center of the distribution, it does not tell us anything about the scores that are the way the scores are scattered in relation to the center. So now, if you take this example on the left hand side, this chart, you have certain values, but look, they are very close to 50. On the right hand side, you have another set of values. They are not close to 50. There is an extreme value 0 and another extreme, that is 98. But if you take the mean of both, that is the mathematical mean for both, it comes as 50 only. Now, in your chapter, there are five methods of measuring dispersion. Range means the highest value minus the lowest value. Suppose you want to go and buy a phone, let us say, and the shopkeeper asks you, what is your range? So he is asking you, what is the minimum cost acceptable to you and what is the maximum cost acceptable to you? Suppose you say 10,000 is my range. So we actually do not mean the difference. What we mean is how much money you can spend. But in statistics, the highest value minus the lowest value is the range. So for shopkeeper, he understands that he can show you anything between 9,000 and 11,000. So he takes out models and shows you this is 9,000 rupees, this is costing 10,000 rupees, and the other one is costing you 11,000 rupees. Now, there's a term called quartile deviation, about which our chapter doesn't speak much about. But we have mean deviation and standard deviation and coefficient of variation. Again, mean deviation, the chapter is not going into any detail, much details. Lorentz curve, although it's mentioned as the method for dispersion measurement, it's not detailed at all in the chapter. Now, standard deviation, if it is an ungrouped data, it is given by this formula, the square root of the summation of the difference between x and x bar. X and x bar, the difference means how much the data is differing from the mean. And then you square that value. Thus, two vertical bars show the modulus. That is, in this case, even if the value is negative, we ignore the negative value. And n is the total number of data points. Now, here's an example. You calculate SD for 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9. So what you do is you in a column, you write 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9. You add them up. You get your sigma summation of x, that is 25. Now, since there were 5 values, when you divide 25 by 5, you get 5. So you get your x bar as 5. Now this x bar you have to subtract from each value of the frequency in your second column. So you get, we go here, it goes 1 minus 5 is minus 4, 3 minus 5 is minus 2, 5 minus 5 is 0, 7 minus 2 is 4, and 9 minus 5 is 0. Now here's a check. If you add all these positive values and negative values and see the difference, it should come to 0. If this you're getting this 0, then it means that whatever you've done so far is correct, and that is vital. In your third column, you have to square this value. That is the reason we said you just ignore the sign, because negative 4 into negative 4 still becomes positive 16. So you have 16, 4, 0, 4, and 16. All right, and then again you sum them up. So 16 plus 4 plus 4 plus 16 is equal to 40. Then you substitute these values in your formula. You get root of 8. Now when you get root of 8, if you ignore the root sign, you get variance. And when you take a square root, you get standard deviation. Now here I want to tell you that it's useful for you to either know how to take the square root by the long method or use a log table if you know how to do it, because that is allowed in examinations, or you learn the value of some the root of some prime numbers such as 2, 5, 7, because by that you can calculate the square values of other numbers, square root values of other numbers as well. Now, if it is a grouped data, see sigma is the sign for standard deviation. This sigma is a Greek alphabet. The chapter gives a formula which is very confusing. Go by this simple formula. Summation of fx square upon summation of x f minus summation of fx upon summation of f the whole square. Alright, this value, this second expression is a whole square. This you have to remember. And the first expression, this bracket isn't there. But otherwise, this formula, both the parts of the formula look so similar. This is important. Now, let's take an example. How you will do it for a group data? First thing to do is to make the class 0 to 3, 4 to 6, 7 to 9, 10 to 12. These are the classes. Then you write the frequencies. Take the sum of the frequencies. That is, in this case, 1 plus 3 plus 1 plus 1 is 6. Now, the next important thing is find the midpoint x. This midpoint x. What do you do is, this is between 0 and 3 in the first column is 2. Between 4 and 6 is 5. Between 7 and 9 is 8. Between 10 and 12 is 11. Mathematically, it is the middle value. 4 plus, that is, 6 minus 4 is 2. 2 upon 2 is 1. So 4 plus 1 is 5. So that is how you find out the middle value. In the next column, you square this middle value. So 2 becomes 4, 5 becomes 25. 8 square is 64 and 11 square is 121. In the next column, you multiply the value of f with value of x. So in the first case, it is 1 into 2 is 2. Second case is 3 into 5 is 15. And then next is 1 into 8 is 8 and 1 into 11 is 11. And take the sum of this. That is, sigma. The summation of fx is 36. Similarly, now you multiply f with the value of x square. So this is the value of x square, 4, 25, 64 and 121, and value of f is 1311. So you have 4, 75, 64 and 121, and take a summation of this. This is sigma fx square, that is 264. Now you have all the values with you, whatever you require. Substitute these values in the formula and keep on solving it till you get a single value under the square root sign. This value without the square root sign is your variance, and after you solve it, after you take a square root, the value that you get, in this case it is 2.282, can be rounded up to 2.83, and that is your standard variation. Coefficient of variation is standard deviation upon mean multiplied by 100. Now, rank correlation is a statistical relationship between two random set of data, and you see how they are relating to each other linearly. So such data will have nature and strength. So nature may be, by nature we mean the direction, and by the strength we mean the degree. In statistics, we represent them as between 0 and plus 1 if it is a strong positive correlation, and between 0 and minus 1 if it is strong negative correlation. Now let us see what is a strong positive correlation. And see, there are two set of value in the left hand side graph. If on the x axis the variables are increasing, and that is also increasing the value on the y axis, that is a positive correlation. That is, one set of values increasing is also increasing the other set of values. In real life, if you look at the demand for any commodity, if the demand is more, then the prices will also increase. Like demand of gold, if it is there, the prices will increase. In the second example, on x axis, if the value is increasing, the value on the y axis, the vertical axis, decreasing. So you have a falling set of blue points, right? The example is the relationship between winter and ice cream. If winter is very severe, the demand of ice cream will fall. Now, these two graphs are an ideal condition, you know, so that we say perfect negative positive and perfect negative correlation. But in reality, it's not so. We hardly find perfect correlationships. That in this case, there are some points which are very far away from the straight line, increasing straight line or decreasing straight line. Now, the last topic in this chapter is Spearman's rank correlation. The formula is given as rho. The symbol which looks like P is pronounced as rho. It's a Greek letter. Rho is equal to 1 minus 6 times summation of d square divided by n times n square minus 1. Here's an example that there are marks of mathematics and economics, and here are 10 students. This is how they are scored out of 10. Now you have to make a correlation, Spearman's correlation. So what you do is, first, in the first column you write all the mathematics marks, second column you write all the economics marks in the same order as it is given in your question. Then what you do is give the rank to mathematics. See, it was out of 10, so the person who got maximum mark gets the highest rank, and just keep on reducing the rank. Similarly, you do it for your economics. Now, if you see in economics, you have this value 0 marks and 10th rank. Alright, then you have the decreasing values, right? So if there are 10 students, and if your least mark is equal to the 10th rank or the last rank, then your arrangement is correct. The next step is to calculate the difference between your ranks. Now, we are not concerned with marks, so you can ignore the first column and the second column. Now, just look at the third column and the fourth column. So 2 minus 9 is 7. Ignore the sign because we are going to square it up. 3 minus 10 is 7. The difference between 3 and 10, difference between 8 and 6, 4 and 2, 5 and 3, and so on and so forth. Alright, then these values you have to square, d square. So minus 7 square is 49, minus square again 49, 2 square is 4, like that you go on. 5 square is 25, minus 4 square is 16, and then you sum them up. That is your summation of d square. Here you get under 92. Now these values you have to put in this formula. Your formula was given here. This RS is same as rho. So you have 1 minus 6 times under 92 upon 100 times 100 square minus 1. So if you keep on solving this gradually, you get 0.16. Here, do not forget to do this step, 1 minus that value. Because if you forget this, because sometimes you can become so preoccupied with the bigger part of the problem that you forget that you have to subtract it from 1. If you forget that, your answer naturally becomes wrong. So don't forget that. So your answer here is 0.16. This is the end of the chapter. Give it a thumbs up if you like it.